is a KOAT Action 7 News Commitment 2021 debate special.
Welcome to the debate for the Congressional District 1 seat. I'm Shelley Robando.
And I'm Doug Fernandez. A special election is happening in June to fill the seat vacated by Deb Haaland. Just months after her re-election, she was confirmed as the U.S. Secretary of the Interior, the first Native American to ever hold that position.
Congressional District 1 serves the central part of New Mexico. That includes Albuquerque and most of Bernalillo County, all of Torrance County, and parts of Sandoval, Santa Fe, and Valencia counties. Six candidates qualified to run for the special election. Two are write-in candidates.
In this debate, you're going to hear from the Republican, Democrat, Libertarian, and Independent candidates. Mark Morris describes himself as a New Mexico native. He was a starter for the Lobos, has 2 degrees from UNM, and owns a business with his wife in the healthcare field. Morris has served as a state senator since 2013, where he is a member of the Senate Judiciary and Rules Committee.
Melanie Stansberry says she was raised in Albuquerque. She's worked in Washington, D.C. with the Senate Committee on Energy and Natural Resources and in the White House Office of Management and Budget. Stansberry holds degrees from St. Mary's College and Cornell University. In 2019, she started a term in the State House as the first woman to serve District 28.
Aubrey Dunn is from Alamogordo. He holds a degree from Colorado State University. He's a rancher who has worked in the banking industry and as a crop inspector. He served as New Mexico's land commissioner and is on the board of directors for the New Mexico Coalition of Conservation Districts.
Chris Manning is from Kirtland. He is an Eagle Scout who served 6 years with the Army National Guard and was deployed to Afghanistan. He holds a degree from Arizona State University where he threw javelin. He's worked for 2 Fortune 500 companies and now runs a small family business. The Albuquerque Journal and KKOB Radio are partnering with us for this debate.
Our panelists are Bob Clark, a host at News Radio KKOB, Kent Waltz, the senior editor at the Albuquerque Journal, and Action 7 News anchor Shelley Robando will be asking the questions of the candidates. I'll be your moderator, and each candidate has a minute and a half to answer questions, and rebuttals are called at my discretion. And Shelley Robando begins with your first question for each of you to answer. Shelley.
Doug, thanks. Candidates, we begin with a topic that's consumed us for more than a year. During the pandemic, some businesses have closed for good or opened in another state. Owners still trying to make it work can't hire enough staff now. As a member of Congress, what should the federal government's role be in helping businesses and the economy? And do you think the American Rescue Plan disincentivizes people from going back to work?
Mr. Morris, you go first.
Thank you, Shelley. Obviously, I'm the most qualified candidate to deal with this issue because for the last year and a half, I've actually been on the front lines working on the COVID crisis. My wife and I are partners in anatomic pathology laboratories. So when the COVID hit, we actually got onto the front lines doing COVID testing. And what we did was we actually moved around the state working with small businesses. And I personally provided over thousands of COVID tests to fellow New Mexicans and helped battle back on the COVID crisis. And what I saw when I went around to small businesses, we actually did went to rapid responses and went at the last minute notice when they had a positive so that we could actually help keep them open. Because when businesses had a positive, they had to get the entire staff tested. And I put on the PPE and the garments and actually the goggles and went there and did the testing myself. And what we really saw is that the small businesses were really taking the brunt of the COVID shutdown. And what we learned as we knew more about COVID was that we had procedures, we knew how to stop the spread, we knew how to wash our hands, we knew how to take care of ourselves, we knew how to wear our masks and social distance. But the businesses continue to take it on the chin. So we do need to open up, we need to move forward, and we got to get these small businesses back so the economy can start roaring again.
Aubrey Dunn, you are next.
Thank you, and I appreciate you inviting me here today. You know, as we went through this pandemic in the beginning, you know, I thought our governor did the right thing in the way she handled it. But as it went further and it became political size between her and the current president, it became obvious that who was really paying for it was small business. When you look at the big boxes, they were given completely different rules in small business, and we've just decimated small business in New Mexico. And it really, I think, was mainly because of MLG. And so if I have an opportunity to go to Congress, number one, it won't be partisan in my decisions. It will be an independent decision just looking out for New Mexico. And what we need to do, I think, is target small business and not big business or big companies for this money. And so we need to get people back to work. But one of the other things we do is we need to get kids back in school. And if you can't get your kids educated and you need to be home working with them at Zoom, then you're not going to be able to have those, you're not going to be able to go to work. So one parent's going to have to stay home. You know, one of those good examples is, you know, even with us at the ranch, our granddaughters come to live with us and 4 days a week to attend school in Corona. That's because she was failing under the Zoom system. So we need to get our kids back to school before we're going to get small businesses back to work. Thank you.
Ms. Stansberry, you are next.
Thank you so much. And thank you so much for having us on tonight. We need to get New Mexicans back to work. And the way we do that is by supporting our families and our communities, investing in jobs, and ensuring, yes, that we get our kids fully back in school and kids have access to childcare. I fully support the American Rescue Plan, and as your next Congresswoman, will work to pass the American Jobs Plan, which will make critical investments in our infrastructure, as well as the American Families Plan, which will invest in education and childcare. We need to get New Mexicans back to work in good paying jobs. And the data are showing that part of the reason people are not going back to work right now is because they're still taking care of their kids and elderly family members who are struggling. I've spent much of the last year helping people access unemployment through our food and hunger work, helping people access food, and addressing the needs directly of our community by grocery shopping and supporting people across our community. New Mexicans are ready to get back to work. We can do this, we have this, and we can do this by making smart investments in our economy at the national, state, and local level.
Mr. Manning, you have the final answer.
Thanks. So my family are small business owners. So we felt the shutdown, personally. One of the silliest things that the governor did was early in the pandemic when there was a run on the grocery stores, she wanted to close down nurseries. Now, my family owns one of the largest greenhouses in the state, and that was, you know, people were flocking there to be able to grow their own vegetables for the summer. But these silly policies that weren't grounded in scientific reason were instituted. Now, at the federal level, I think that there is a disincentive that is being put out there with the plus up from the Unemployment Act. And this is an incidence of Congress with a well-intentioned idea. But the unintended consequences are having a negative effect. And we feel it particularly here in New Mexico. We have the third highest unemployment rate in the nation right now at over 8%. And we still have multiple business restrictions, even though we arbitrarily changed the color code of the counties the other day. Again, something not founded in scientific evidence or basis of fact, but simply arbitrary numbers that the Department of Health and Dr. Schrace have created. We went from mostly a green-yellow situation to turquoise overnight. No, and right now there is no justification for any of the restrictions, and that's what I would argue. I would argue that at this point, we know the risks. We know where COVID happens and where it doesn't.
Your time is up. Your time is up. Thank you. Kent Waltz with the Albuquerque Journal has the next question for, again, all four candidates.
Thank you, Doug. As a member of Congress, would you support or oppose laying the groundwork now to federalize the response to a COVID-type outbreak in the future? In that scenario, issues such as mask mandates, stay-at-home orders, and business capacity limits would come from Washington. Or do you think the response should continue to be handled primarily at the state level?
Melanie Stansberry, you go first.
We need to follow the science. What I support is following the science. And what we have seen is over the last several months, our president has taken the science seriously and gotten to work and worked with our businesses, with our pharmaceutical companies, our states, our tribes, and our communities to make sure that people are getting vaccinated, that we're addressing the needs of our communities, and that people are safe. I would support efforts at the federal level to have coordination across our states, across our tribes, and across our communities. But of course, we need to also have the flexibility to implement at the local level in the ways that make the most sense. So it's critical that we follow the science, that we have national baseline standards to ensure people are safe, and that we're partnering with our communities and really centering our community's health needs as we do that.
Mr. Manning, you're next.
No, I'm against a top-down approach in this. And I think the failures over the last year of the federal government show the reason why. It was the CDC that contaminated the first testing samples. And so our testing was delayed because the CDC wouldn't allow private or independent labs to do their own testing. It had to come from Washington, D.C. The FDA wouldn't certify independent labs. If you weren't already bought into the system, you couldn't get the testing supplies out. Whereas in a distributed system, the local laboratories could have. The University of Washington finally ignored the FDA and started producing their own testing, so that way the citizens of Washington could get tested. Now, there should be some guidance and there should be some general guidelines from the federal government, but particularly in a pandemic, it spreads unevenly. And even with a statewide mandate, you saw that wasn't the right way to go either, because there were cases where early in the pandemic, some of the counties had zero cases and yet they were shut down. So even I would never be supportive of a federal mandate. And I think the Biden administration's confusing guidance coming from the CDC right now showed that. The Journal of American Medical Association came out with a study back in June last year that children should be in school full time. And yet here they are today, still not in school full time. That's what the science says, and we ignore it at the federal level.
Mr. Dunn, you are next.
Thank you. No, I am totally against sending more power to the federal government on how we handle these type things. And in fact, I think in New Mexico, we've given too much power to the governor. If we approach one of these pandemics again, I think we should have a joint task force made up of legislatures and the executive branch, and not give all the power to just one person who turned into a tyrant during this thing and shut down small businesses, caused tons of losses, and it has really hurt our children and not being in school. So giving more power to the federal government, I'm totally against. And it seems like someone would want to do that only if they're really not tied to the local people. And so I want to go as an independent and just work for New Mexicans. Thank you.
And Mr. Morris.
Thank you, Kent. This is obviously a multifaceted problem. And we live in a federal system of government. Where the federal government really can help is with the research and the might that they can bring resources to fight a future pandemic or any other crisis that we face. However, the states are much more nimble in dealing with local issues and statewide issues. So it really is a multifaceted issue. What the federal government can do immediately is help bring American jobs and manufacturing back, for medical manufacturing back into the state, for pharmaceutical manufacturing back into New Mexico and across the country. And right now we create a lot of disincentives for manufacturing here in the nation. And so when the pandemic started, again, we were on the front lines, but we couldn't find PPE. We couldn't get supplies and reagents for our COVID testing because the manufacturing was all overseas. And that's one thing the federal government really must focus on, so we can bring back those jobs and so that we can address those issues in the future here in New Mexico and in the state. But when it comes down to actually responding to the individual pandemic, because it will happen again. It happened 100 years ago, in which my grandfather Elipio was orphaned up in Española, and it will happen again. And so we have to be prepared for that. And a big part of that is making sure those manufacturing abilities come back to America.
Our rules for this debate allow for questions directed to individual candidates, all of them or some. KKOB's Bob Clark has one directed to Chris Manning.
Mr. Manning, the 1st Congressional District represents Albuquerque and the surrounding rural areas. Now, campaign filing reports show you have an address. You live in Kirtland, which is in the Four Corners near Farmington. How do you convince the voters in this district that you can represent their best interests when you live 3 hours away?
Mr. Manning, you have 90 seconds.
I think I'm demonstrating it by providing the solutions that New Mexico voters want and CD1. I think that as I'm getting emails from lifelong Democrats and Republicans, they see that I am not the same politician that they've been getting year after year after year with a D or an R next to them. They see that I come with solutions and they see that I come with facts. At the end of the day, the voters of New Mexico and CD1 are going to say, okay, well, who's going to represent me the best? Who's going to take my voice and bite for me in D.C., and that's going to be me. Now, I don't take any money from corporations. I don't take any money from unions. And so my campaign is funded 100% by citizens. At the end of the day, the voters of CD1 are going to say what is most important. And it's not going to be my address. It's going to be my policy. And it's going to be who I am as a person. And I hope that that's what they're going to see.
Both candidates, Melanie Stansberry and Mark Moores, represent New Mexico in the state legislature. Kent Waltz has the next question for both of them. Kent.
Two of the most controversial issues in the session that just ended were the passage of a state civil rights act that makes it easier to sue police officers and other state employees, and a mandatory paid sick leave policy that applies to private sector employers but not to government agencies. How did you vote on these measures and why?
Mr. Moores, you go first.
Thank you for those questions. I voted against both those measures, and the Civil Rights Act really was very dangerous as we move forward. What we're doing is we're vilifying the police officers who are trying to make our streets safer by actually making them more criminal. They could actually be sued for their actions in what if the police officer hesitates and worries, people are going to die. And really what that was a trial attorney economic development plan that obviously my supporter is heavily supported by the trial attorneys. And what we're going to see is a huge financial burden on small cities and counties and municipal organizations. And it's trial attorneys are really going to make a fortune. And Melanie Stansberry really stood with the trial attorneys instead of our local communities on that. The second was paid sick leave act. You know, it was atrocious that the government passed a law mandating that small businesses pay sick leave. But when we ran an amendment in committee, they rejected it to allow it to apply for government agencies and state government. That was hypocrisy. And the Democrats who control Santa Fe and did that, and Ms. Stansberry did it also, they said small businesses have to do this, but us as government agencies refuse to do that. And that is the hypocrisy I think New Mexicans are tired of, is that what's good for small businesses should also have been good for government.
Ms. Stansberry, your reply.
Thank you. I voted in favor of both of these pieces of legislation because I stand with our communities, I stand for social justice, and I stand for our workers. So first, let's talk about the Civil Rights Act. The Civil Rights Act purpose was to end qualified immunity, and it was a recommendation that came from the Civil Rights Commission, which was advising our state on actions to take regarding criminal justice reform in the wake of the George Floyd murder. So it was a critical first step in addressing social and racial justice in our state, and I support ending qualified immunity at the national level as well. Now, with respect to paid sick leave, we have thousands of New Mexicans who have been frontline workers who've been working out there helping to feed us, helping to ensure that there's still supplies in the grocery stores, healthcare workers, all of these workers that are out there working every single day. Other states like Colorado had passed a paid sick leave provision to make sure that our frontline workers and other workers could take leave when they were feeling ill. This was a public health measure, it's a workers' rights measure, and it will enable our families to thrive. So I stand with our workers, I stand with our communities, and that is why I voted in favor of both of those bills. Thank you.
Shelley Urbando has the next question for the four candidates. Shelley.
The influx of immigrants along the U.S.-Mexico border has created a heated debate. Members of the president's own party have criticized how it's been handled. The White House has resisted calling this a crisis. So two questions for you. Is it a crisis, and do you support President Biden's immigration policy?
Mr. Dunn, you go first.
Is it a crisis? Yes, it's a crisis. It's a huge crisis. But it's an issue that's been going on for decades. And no, I do not support the handling by President Biden on it. You know, I've been on the border, I've ridden horseback on the border, and, you know, there's places where, you know, we talk about a wall, but we really need a fence just to keep the Mexican cattle out of the American cattle so we don't have disease transfer. So when you talk about immigration, I think that we need a real solution, and it's become so partisan on the way it's handled. But I think we need to get workers' visas in, we need to get resident visas in. At the ranch, we've got a fellow working for another company that's in. He's been working in the United States for almost 20 years, and he had to wait 2 years to get a visa to come back just recently. And so there's people that want to work and have jobs, but they want to add to the system, not take away. And so I think we need to increase the number of people we have coming into the country and fix our immigration problem. Because right now, the open border is unbelievable in what's going on down there and the amount of traffic that's coming across. But we need to send the criminals back, and we need to work more on getting people that want jobs to have jobs to come to the United States and have an immigration policy that allows them to work and be in the system and not taken advantage of by unscrupulous employers.
Mr. Moores, you are next.
Thank you. It is absolutely a crisis what is happening on the border right now. It's a humanitarian crisis, and we need to make sure we address the humanitarian needs down there and finish securing our border. No nation can actually survive if it doesn't control its own border. But America has long been the shining city on the hill. We are a nation of immigrants, of legal immigration, And that is part of our DNA. And we need to address this issue fairly. For those who've been standing in line in their home countries for the opportunity to come to America for liberty and prosperity for themselves and their children, America welcomes them and always has and always will. But we need to make sure that border is secure and that the system is fair. Now, my opponent, Melanie Stansberry's support of what's called the BREATHE Act is actually downright dangerous. She has called for the ending of the Immigration and Control Agency. She has asked for it includes banning the Border Patrol. It takes away the crime of entering the country illegally. It calls for the destruction and closing of all immigration centers. That is just downright dangerous. And who believes that it's all right to stop deportations of illegal immigrants into this country, even if they commit crimes? Yes, that's right. She actually supports the BREATHE Act, which would say all deportations are banned, even if they're criminals. So please look up the breatheact.org. Take a look at that piece of legislation that Ms. Stansberry supports, right, and you'll
see
how—
Your time is up, Mr. Morris. Thank you. Mr. Manning, you are next.
We've been talking about immigration reform since the mid-90s, when President Clinton tapped Barbara Jordan, the first Black woman to be elected to Congress, and asked her to head the immigration plan. And yet here we are, more than 20 years later, and it still hasn't, you know, nothing's been happening in Congress. And the reason for that is because the Democrats and Republicans want to fight each other on immigration, and they don't want the other party to get a win when it comes to immigration reform. And that's the truth of the matter. If you really want to peel back the curtain, it's just because one party doesn't want the other party to get credit for the immigration reform that we need. And that's why I put forth a solution to, I think, what we have going on right now. Yes, it is a crisis, and I call it the obvious lie when President Joe Biden and his administration refuse to say that. And that's what a lot of politicians do. They tell you the obvious lie so that way you don't see what you actually see. Now, the solution is a reform to our asylum process. And the first one is we have to recognize that under current law, asylees who wish to apply for asylum have to be at the border or a port of entry in order to apply for asylum. That's why I advocate for allowing people to apply for asylum in their home country. That also allows the federal government to validate people, ensure that they do have a valid asylum claim. And the second thing is I'm a proponent of increasing legal immigration by 300,000 to 500,000 people a year. If we do that, we grant more people the honor of being American citizens, and we'll have a lot more patriots come in this country every year.
And Ms. Stansberry.
Yes, thank you. The situation at the border is absolutely something that we have to address through a humanitarian lens. We have thousands of people arriving at our southern border right now who are fleeing catastrophic drought, violence, and other economic conditions in their home countries, as well as thousands of children that are arriving without their parents. We have to address this issue by providing humanitarian aid, by providing help and support for home countries to ensure we are addressing the economic and human security of these communities. And we have to address our asylum system. We have to ensure that there's appropriate resources, and we need to be passing bipartisan, comprehensive immigration reform in Congress that protects our dreamers, that provides a path to citizenship, and that ensures that we have an immigration and an asylum system that is fair, just, and equitable. So that is how we address this issue, and I do stand with President Biden and his administration and my colleagues on both sides of the aisle who are calling for action to address these issues urgently.
And Bob Clark has the next directed question for the independent candidate.
Mr. Dunn, you certainly bill yourself as the candidate in this race with the most experience to represent rural voters, not just of CD1, but throughout the state of New Mexico. What is your vision for health care reform, and what in Congress would you be able to do to help rural residents around the state, especially when it comes to health care access?
You have 90 seconds for your reply.
Thank you for the question. And you know, it is an issue, but it's not medical access is not just an issue for us in the rural economy, but also within the city. And I think what we need to do is we need to put more money towards funding nurse practitioners, assistants, medical assistants, and get people out and give them the authority to act in the medical gap that we have in the country. The other thing we need to make is have insurance portable between states, and we need to break up the great big insurance cartels. I mean, we need to get a handle on our healthcare. It is a big problem in rural areas, but I think by giving more training and enabling nurse practitioners and others within those small communities the ability to treat some of the least critical care, I think it would help greatly. Thank you.
Well, the rules allow for each candidate to ask a question. Mr. Moores, you go first, and that opponent has 90 seconds to reply.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to ask this question because it's very concerning. Melanie, you supported the BEREAVE Act, and on their website, it talks about that we cannot have justice and liberation in America until we end all policing, prisons, and all punishment paradigms. It also calls for the elimination of the terrorist watch list. And you know what? It also calls for a reduction of 10% in military spending. In your thesis at Cornell University, you talked about America being an imperial empire. And now New Mexico has two national laboratories, 3 Air Force bases, and 2 Army installations. With that 10% reduction in military spending that you're proposing, which base are you planning on closing?
Thank you so much for this question. Well, I do have a master's in sociology from Cornell University, and I am a STEM professional that works in water resources management, that has worked with our tribes and communities across the state. And I've worked at the federal level in the White House and the Office of Management and Budget in the United States Senate, and have extensive experience working in our communities across the state on economic development and natural resources issues. And ultimately, at the end of the day, I am running for Congress to ensure that our communities are safe, that we can invest in the prosperity and safety and human well-being, and I stand for social justice. So I will fight for New Mexicans in Congress. I will ensure that we are passing laws that protect people's rights and that address our economic and social welfare.
Okay, Ms. Stansbury, you have a question for one of your opponents.
Yes, thank you. I would like to ask this question of Senator Moores. So, Senator Moores, we both serve in the legislature, and you have voted twice against a bill that would end a antiquated and unconstitutional abortion ban that was put on the books in 1969. How can you explain why you took this vote, and do you trust women to make their own decisions?
First off, I am pro-life. That bill was passed in 1969, as you mentioned, by a Democrat legislature. And it has been in place for 52 years when Democrats have actually controlled both the House and the Senate the entire time. And so I am pro-life because, you know, in New Mexico, we are the late abortion capital of the world. You know, the first time I held my daughter in my arms, and it was just moments after she was born. Under New Mexico law that you support, Melanie, just moments before I held her in my arms, she could have been killed. She wasn't a blob of cells. She was a human being. I also oppose having taxpayers be forced to pay for abortions. In New Mexico, you have supported late-term abortions up to birth. Now, I'd be happy to actually give you the rest of my time because you did not answer my question about which military base you would close here in New Mexico after your radical proposal to defund the military by 10%. 3 Air Force bases, 2 Army installations, 2 national laboratories. And it's very obvious you have a responded question wrote answer, but you didn't answer the question, Melanie. So please tell New Mexicans which military base you think is worthy of closing to meet your reduction in military.
Time is up. We're going to go ahead and move on to the next candidate. Mr. Manning, please ask your question to one of your opponents. Now, 30 seconds again, please.
So this is going to be airing on Mother's Day, so I think it's appropriate to acknowledge that. And so, Aubrey, my question is for you, since I think we kind of get left out of that back and forth. Tell me your favorite memory of your mother.
My favorite memory of my mother. Well, my mother was a PE teacher down in Alamogordo. And I appreciate you giving me a positive question since it's Mother's Day. But probably the one of the greatest things she taught me was how to play tennis. And so, you know, my mom is still alive. She's 91 years old, lives in Wichita Falls, Texas, and still drives a car. But her teaching me how to play tennis is probably my greatest memory, and I appreciate her for doing that. So thank you, Chris.
Not a normal debate question, but it was very insightful. Thank you. Well, Mr. Dunn, it's now your opportunity to ask a question of one of your opponents.
Well, I probably won't be as nice. Representative Stansbury, you know, I've been in New Mexico. I just turned 65, and so I get Medicare, which I'm very happy about. And I've been in politics off and on for quite a bit as our family. And I just haven't run across you. And I'm sorry we haven't met in person. But I have a lingering question. It seems like you've only been back in the state about 48 months. And it almost appears you've come here to run for office. And so you state that you're a consultant and a water expert. And, you know, I do a lot of water work with the land office. So I just kind of like to know really how long you've been here and what you really do as a consultant.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Dunn. I really appreciate that question. So I'm a native New Mexican. I was born and raised here. I grew up right here in Albuquerque. I went to public schools here. I've worked here throughout my career. I grew up in a working family of small businesses, and I've worked in all different sectors in our state. And in 2010, I had the extraordinary opportunity to go work in the White House during the Obama administration. And so I packed up my bags. I was living here in New Mexico at the time, working on my PhD research, looking at land and water rights here in New Mexico. And I went to Washington, and I thought I was going to stay for 6 months and ended up staying for almost 7 years. And when I moved home, I started a consulting practice to help advise on how do we translate the physical science of water and climate change into plans and policies to help us get through drought and the changes that are already impacting our communities. So I do work with philanthropy, with different research organizations and nonprofits across the state. And I really appreciate the question, and it's nice to be here with you today.
And Shelley Urbando has the next question for all of the candidates to answer. Shelley.
For years, our state's biggest city has been a hotspot for violent crimes. What can really be done at the federal level to combat this? Because many people watching right now have been victims, and they want to know they can feel safe living here.
Mr. Manning, you go first.
Now, at the federal level, let's be honest, there are some things that Congress can do. And this is one of those issues that I see as a local issue. And the highest correlation between crime is going to be education and unemployment. I've cited this before, but The Guardian ran an article a couple of years ago titled "To Solve Crime, Think Local." And what it shows is there's a very high correlation between school dropout and male unemployment and crime. And so the biggest, you know, the best way in order to prevent crime is to attack the what causes it. And that's dropout rates and unemployment. And so one of the things that I advocate for at the federal level is going to be school vouchers or savings accounts for parents. And what this would allow you then as a parent is to be able to take those federal taxpayer dollars and use them at whatever school you think is best for your children, whatever you think is going to give them the best opportunity to succeed. And I'm not interested in funding the systems or the teachers' unions. I'm interested in letting parents decide where's best to send their taxpayer dollars in order to fund their children's education. And we need to revamp our education system. Instead of focusing so much on education, we also need to teach trade skills in our high schools. We need to teach culinary arts, barbers, whatever it is. I want you to leave high school with a skill set that pays better than minimum wage. And that's my ultimate goal.
Time is up. Thank you. Ms. Stansberry, you're next.
Thank you so much. You know, as somebody who grew up here in Albuquerque, my heart just truly breaks when I see the amount of crime and social issues that are affecting our community. And I agree a lot with what Mr. Manning is saying. I believe we have to bring critical investments home to help support our public safety. And that is why in the state legislature, since I've been serving since 2019, I have helped to coordinate the city's capital outlay program around public safety funding. And in doing that, we've been able to bring tens of millions of dollars home to help support our police officers and public safety officials to address crime with more smart technology and investments in our safety. But we also have to address and reform our policing system and invest in our communities and the kinds of things that Mr. Manning is talking about. Investments in education, investments in behavioral health, investments in growing our economy. And so as your next Congresswoman, I will ensure that we are doing both, that we are making smart investments in our public safety as well as investments in the well-being of our community.
Mr. Dunn, you're next.
Thank you. You know, you listen to Bob Clark every morning or different radio stations talk about the number of deaths each day here in Albuquerque, and it's it's heart-wrenching and scary at the same time. I mean, we're highest in crime, lowest in education. And, you know, one of the things I think that caused this is when we did the change in bail bonds. And, you know, I understand. I mean, if Chris and I have the same crime and he doesn't have the funds to get out of jail and I do, then it's really not equitable. But I think what's happening is we have a lot of criminals that are just flowing through the system, get an ankle bracelet, and then go rob somebody's house or shoot somebody or whatever crime they do. And so from a federal level, I think what we could do is we could get money into the court system in New Mexico to actually keep people at home on ankle monitor and not let them go out and commit crimes. Because I think a lot of the thing is we're slapping a ankle bracelet on them and out they go and do whatever crime they want to do. We need to get further training into the police, and not just New Mexico, but not just Albuquerque, but all over. And so I think getting federal dollars that aren't tied to certain federal things, but tied to helping New Mexico would be one way Congress could help in this item. So, but still, I think we need to monitor the criminals that create and not just create a revolving door like we have now. We need to enforce the laws we have on the books. Thank you.
And Mr. Morris, you are next.
Thank you. Crime in Albuquerque and Central Mexico is out of control. This morning, I had a meeting with a group of law enforcement officers from right here in Albuquerque. And right now, we're looking at least 45 murders, 75% more than we ever had ever in New Mexico and Central New Mexico. Crime is just destroying this community. Now, Ms. Stansberry just took credit for bringing millions of dollars of capital outlay to Albuquerque for law enforcement. Well, that's including capital outlay that I helped appropriate and help get for our schools and our police forces. So that's a typical kind of politician trying to take credit for something that she really had nothing to do with, and then taking credit for some work other people did. Because if she was so successful fighting crime, then those 45 murders are at her feet. Because that is the kind of failed leadership we don't need in Washington. If she was so successful fighting crime and we have this record number of murders, well, maybe it's time for new leadership. Because her actual action, and the reason she ran is running a TV ad right now, is to hide her incredibly radical proposal on the BREATHE Act. Go to breatheact.org and look at this. It would completely defund police and prisons, including emptying federal prisons within 10 years. That's right, 10 years. Does anyone think that makes any sense?
I'm going to go ahead and call for a rebuttal here because you said 45 murders might be at her feet. Ms. Stansberry, quickly reply to what he said about that.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. Well, first of all, my record is clear. I have made major investments myself and helped to coordinate massive amounts of public safety funding coming back to Albuquerque for smart investments in our public safety technology and for our law enforcement. But secondly, I want to say that our country is having a critical discussion right now about criminal justice reform and policing and systemic racism. And I find it offensive and deeply unconscionable that it is being politicized in this manner.
Kent Waltz has the next question for all four candidates. Rebuttal replies are limited to 30 seconds, please. Kent, go ahead.
In the wake of recent shootings, President Biden has taken some steps towards gun control by executive order, but he is urging Congress to do more, including a ban on assault-style weapons. What is your position on this, and what would you do to address the millions of those weapons legally owned by Americans now?
Ms. Stansberry, you go first.
Thank you, Kent, for the question. I support reinstating the assault weapon ban and gun buyback programs because our country is facing an epidemic in gun violence. Our kids are literally afraid to go to school. In Congress, I will support common sense gun safety laws, including universal background checks, reinstatement of the assault weapon ban, gun buyback programs, and critical investments in community intervention, prevention, and mental health programs, because we have to address this issue now. The absolute safety of our communities depends on it.
Mr. Manning, you're next.
And this is an area where I'm clearly opposed to Ms. Stansberry on that. We had an assault weapons ban in the 90s, and the CDC did a study on it, showed that it had zero effect on crime or murder rates. So it doesn't make sense to implement a policy which already shown to have no effect. Again, the effect isn't, the solution isn't taking the guns. That's not what's going to change crime. You have to change society. And that's not something that's easy to say. It's easy to blame the gun, but it is hard to recognize that really what we have to change is the person behind the gun. And I don't like that she uses the fear of children afraid to go to school when we need to talk about the reality of school shootings. They are very rare. They do happen, but they're extremely rare. And NPR ran an article a couple of years ago talking about all the school shootings that weren't. And unfortunately, the media a lot of times leads on and tells you that there are over 200 school shootings a year, when really the number is 9 or 10. Now, I'm a very staunch defender of all individual liberties. Every constitutional right that is, you know, laid out there in the Constitution, I'm going to defend, and it includes guns. We also have to talk about defensive gun use. The CDC ran a study and showed that defensive gun use happens 1 million times a year. And I think that is far more important than looking at mass shootings, which happen 9 or 10 times a year. I'm not going to infringe on your individual liberties. I think it's a bad policy, and it's one that I would oppose.
All right, Mr. Manning, thank you. Mr. Moores, you are next.
Thank you. First, I want to go back to a comment that Ms. Stansberry said. She said she made investments herself. I like to point out that that is a radical progressive idea. The investments came from the taxpayers. In fact, those investments that she was talking about came from the oil and gas industry, which she is adamantly opposed to. So I would think that she would consider that dirty money. And if those investments were made by the taxpayers in the oil and gas industry, they weren't made for her. I also am proud to be a supporter of the Second Amendment. I have been endorsed by the NRA. I have a strong track record of standing up for gun rights in Santa Fe, and I'll continue to do that in Washington, D.C. The bills that we're talking about really deal with what a gun looks like. And I have a huge problem with the federal government, state governments coming in and taking away weapon or any firearm from someone who is using it for lawful purposes, for hunting, shooting, sports, whatever they're using it for, that is lawful. That is what America is about. It's in our Constitution, and I will stand for the Second Amendment. But it is very telling that my opponent considers your taxpayer money her investment. Thank you.
Mr. Dunn, you have the final answer.
Thank you, and I appreciate that. You know, I'm 100% for the Second Amendment and completely against the ban on assault weapons. And really, they're not assault weapons. And some of the numbers people don't talk about, in 2016, there were 7,000 gun homicides. Two-thirds of those were suicides. And majority of those were all with handguns, not rifles. And if you look at gun violence in schools, a child has a greater chance of being killed in a car wreck than in a school violence. So I think we're attacking the wrong thing. You know, they say guns do three things. They function, they fail, or they rust. But violence is in the heart of the person. It's not the gun that is the violence. So any kind of restriction on Second Amendment rights, I'm totally against. I would probably the only one on this stage tonight that actually has fired a firearm within the last week. I had a Badger that had torn up one of my water tanks, and I had a semi-automatic pistol that I used to dispose of him. But, you know, I would question, some people in this debate don't even own guns or have fired them. And so I think that the Second Amendment is not just for hunting and self-protection. But
all right, Mr. Dunn, your time is up. Thank you. Now, we heard from a lot of voters with questions for all the candidates. Amber Bennett lives in Albuquerque and asks this.
My question is, will you help get student loans forgiven due to the high amount of student loans debt that exists currently?
Right. Well, of course, student loan forgiveness is a hot debate. And the CARES Act does provide some benefits, but these are slated to go away in September. Do the candidates, do you think student loan relief should be extended or made permanent?
Mr. Moores, you go first.
You know, higher education is a center part of the American dream. Both my parents were first generation college graduates, went on to get doctorates in special education, and were teachers of the deaf their whole life. It is a life-changing opportunity. Both my mother, Julia Maestas, got her doctorate in linguistics from the University of Minnesota. My father, his doctorate in the University of Illinois. It changed our life. But I do have a problem with those who expect to go to very expensive out-of-state schools or Ivy League schools. They would make that financial decision to not actually stay in state or go to a community college but choose to go to extremely expensive schools, and then they want the taxpayers to pay for it. That's just not fair. There are opportunities in New Mexico to stay here and actually have a taxpayer-subsidized education, a very qualified, quality-subsidized education. And I went to UNM on a football scholarship, so I was very lucky for that opportunity. I got a master's in business afterwards, and I was really supportive of the taxpayers who helped me do that and stay here in New Mexico. And that's been part of my public service ever since here in the state. You know, I didn't go to a fancy out-of-state school, so probably I don't have the ability to articulate some of those things that and memorize talking points like we've seen today. But, you know, I do think it's unfair that someone chooses to spend tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of dollars in college education out-of-state that they really should pay for it themselves.
Ms. Stansberry, you are next.
Thank you so much. I do support student loan forgiveness, because education is the cornerstone of our community well-being and economic opportunity. I grew up right here in Albuquerque in a working class family and was fortunate enough to be able to go to college on a scholarship. But for so many people in our communities, they don't have that opportunity and have to take on significant debt in order to advance their education and get training and whatever trades and skills and education that they decide to pursue in their careers. I think that it is the cornerstone of a thriving economy, of a community, and the well-being of our families to be able to get that higher education. So I do support student loan forgiveness. It's good for our families, it's good for our communities, and it's good for our economy.
Mr. Dunn, your reply.
Thank you for the question. You know, New Mexico has one of the highest dropout rates in the entire country. And, you know, we talk about student debts, and I'll tell you right now, I'm not in favor of forgiving student debt. But I don't think everybody needs to go to college either. And we've come to this belief that the only way you can be successful is to go to college. And I think that's wrong. If we're going to help people, I think we ought to help them within trades. And I think one of the main things we should do is in high school, we should train people that they, if they want to be an auto mechanic or a plumber or an electrician, which is impossible to find where I live, and train them to have a skill that they can make money on. I mean, a lot of people are going to college, and especially some of those asking for the forgiveness of debt, that end up with a degree they could do nothing with. And so I really think that we should focus more on getting our graduation rate up in high school and working with those people that aren't college bound to have jobs when they get out of college. And I think that would, that, or whenever they get out of high school. And I think that would change the whole focus. If I could go to high school and come out as an apprentice electrician, make $20,000 to $30,000 a year, and then end up with a salary of $70,000 or $80,000, I think that's a great way to go. And I don't think we should force everybody into this college system. I don't think that's a measure of success. I think the measure of success is what you do with what your talents. Thank you.
And Mr. Manning.
I'm not a supporter of student loan debts. I personally had $40,000 in loans when I came out of college. I wasn't lucky enough to get a scholarship. My family wasn't very well off. But I took on those debts knowing that they had to be paid back. And I don't think that that really breeds that personal responsibility that we need to instill in this nation again, that we are responsible for the things that we do. But we have to look at what is causing that increase in student loans. We have to look at what is the cause of it. Now, part of it is the nationalization of the student loans. During the Obama administration, they, in essence, nationalized the student loans. What have you seen? Since then, if the government's willing to back anybody and give you an unlimited amount of money to go to college, they do. They don't pay attention to what degree you're in or the prospects of you paying it back. They simply hand it out. And that's part of the problem. That led to an increase in tuition rates. As an example, my first semester at ASU, I paid $1,500. My last semester in 2011, it was $4,500. I saw a 200% increase in tuition costs because the federal government is just a money spigot at that point. And that's what we have to address. We have to stop just handing out money by the tens of thousands. We also have to understand, I think the student loan forgiveness is oversold by the Democratic Party. Only 15% of Americans own student loan, and anything greater than $10,000 in forgiveness.
And Mr. Manning, your time is up. Each candidate now has 2 minutes for closing statements. They will speak in an order selected through a random drawing. And Mr. Manning, you go first, 2 minutes.
Thank you. If you're watching this and you've watched this entire day, I think you see that there is a very large difference between the way that I have approach this campaign in the way that I want to represent the voters of New Mexico City want. I think I show that I'm very much solutions oriented. I look at what the problem is, what is the driver of that problem, and how to correct it. And that's what I'm going to take to DC. Not only that, I'm focused on the voters. I'm not interested in engaging in the tribal warfare between the parties that we've been engaged in for the last several years and decade. I'm not interested in continuing that. And I've been getting emails from lifelong Democrats and Republicans in the district telling me that they're thankful for that and that they want to support me. And I'm seeing a lot of drivers from the old parties. And I want you to know that whether you're a Republican or a Democrat, I'm going to support you. I'm going to advocate for you. I'm not tied to any special interests. I'm not tied to any corporations. None of them give me any money. They have no leverage over me. My job in DC is to represent you. And I hope that when you step into the ballot box into the ballot booth on June 1st, you cast that vote for me. Thank you.
Ms. Stansberry, your closing statement, 2 minutes.
Thank you so much. And thank you to everyone out there who's been watching today and to all of our candidates for sharing your visions and your ideas about how to advance New Mexico. I am Democratic Representative Melanie Stansberry, and I am running for Congress because I believe in New Mexico and I believe in our future. I have dedicated my career to serving our communities as a staffer, as a researcher, and a public servant, working in the White House, the Senate, and the legislature, and in communities across our state. I grew up right here in Albuquerque, in the North Valley and the West Side, went to Albuquerque Public Schools and graduated from Cibola High School. And I grew up in a working family, growing up working construction and bussing tables. I know what it's like to struggle to make ends meet and the work we must do to rebuild our economy and jobs, to address social and economic justice in our communities, to tackle hunger and homelessness and drought and climate change. But to do so, we need to elect somebody with vision who will work with President Biden and across the aisle to deliver for New Mexico. We need to elect someone who knows the science, who knows our communities, and will roll up their sleeves and get to work for our people. That is why I'm running to be your next Congresswoman, because as a New Mexican, I know that we have what it takes to get the job done and the grit and determination and heart to do it. Thank you and have a good night.
And Mr. Morris, you are next.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you all putting on this forum tonight. It's been very informative. It showed a very stark difference between candidates. I am very proudly a New Mexican, and that's why I am running for office. My family first came to New Mexico, what is now New Mexico, in the 1600s. I'm a proud Norteño. My mother, Julia Maestas, had the opportunity to become a teacher of the deaf. My grandpa, Lipio, who I mentioned earlier, was orphaned by the Spanish flu. And our family goes back generation and generations working the land of northern New Mexico, digging ditches, acequias, and farming. And that is why I'm so proud of being New Mexican. And I'm so concerned about the direction of the state. The radical agenda that is wanting to fundamentally change New Mexico is scary. Out of control crime here in New Mexico, in central New Mexico, with 45 murders. And we have a radical proposal to actually close down prisons and defund the police. And, you know, it's just scary what is happening in the state because I love this so much. My children live here. My two grandchildren are going to public school right now. And Lisa and I have been healthcare professionals here in the state of New Mexico on the front lines fighting COVID. And that is actually what I really need to emphasize here, is that this race is about someone who is a small business owner, someone who cares passionately about New Mexico, someone who has served this state and actually given so much back to the state, versus really a Washington insider. And that's what we're doing. We're moving forward. We're going to fight for New Mexico. We're going to fight for small businesses in this radical agenda that is just tearing apart New Mexico. We're going to take care of our families. And that is really what I want to do, because policy, what was heard tonight was a lot of memorized answers, but no real, or memorized responses with no real answers to the tough questions. And what really voters should be tired of just someone coming on
here. Mr. Morris, your time is up. Thank you. Mr. Dunn, you have the final closing statement.
Thank you, and thank you all for putting this on and being the only TV station that invited me. You know, I've grown up in New Mexico. My father is a native New Mexican. I have a son who's a third generation New Mexican. So I understand the state. And, you know, I've been a banker for 25 years. I retired there. We've ranched throughout New Mexico. We currently are going through the drought like everyone else. And so I understand that some of the challenges of small business in very different ways. But, you know, I think we're at a crossroads. We're number one in crime and we're last in education. And the two-party system that we've been in just has not brought us solutions. And I think it's time New Mexicans had a choice for an independent thinker that will do independent things and look not out for the two parties, but will look out for the people of New Mexico. You know, as we've talked through it all, I think you've seen the differences. And as land commissioner, I got an opportunity to serve and create revenue, which helps save over $2,000 per family in New Mexico in taxes. So I'm here just to help you. I'm not a Trump teddy bear, nor am I a Biden puppet. A lot of people talk about, well, I'm going to support President Biden. Well, I'm going to support New Mexicans. That's the only people I'm going to support. So if you send me to Congress, I'll be there for you and not for the party. So please elect me. Go to AubreyDunn.com. Thank you.
Mr. Dunn, Mr. Manning, Mr. Morris, and Ms. Stansbury, thank you very much for taking part in this very important debate to replace the now Secretary of the Interior, Deb Holland. Thank you.
There are a number of ways you can cast your ballot in this election. If you live in the district, early voting is underway now at the county clerk's office on Lomas. Additional early voting locations open on May 15th. May 18th is the last day to request absentee ballots, and military overseas voters can request an electronic ballot through May 25th. May 29th is the last day of early voting. And election day is June 1st. Polls will be open from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. This is how the district breaks down in terms of voters. 47% are Democrats, 28% Republicans, 1% Libertarian, and 24% unaffiliated. More than 458,000 voters are registered in the district.
KOAT, our partners at News Radio KKOB and the Albuquerque Journal are committed to helping you understand the issues and the candidates when you go to the polls. You can find this debate and more candidate information at KOAT.com, ABQJournal.com, and NewsRadioKKOB.com.
On election night, you can turn to all of us for the latest results.
Thank you for joining us, and good night.